Today on Typical Books, we're going to be talking about the Boris Karloff Horror Anthology. I had a great time reading this book. So it is a typical book in that it is a hardcover book. It is put out by Souvenir Press, not a press that I'm very familiar with. No doubt some sort of old-timey imprint that no one is really that familiar with, I don't think. The cover art is striking. It is a jester, so reminding me of course, the Cask of Amontillado, which is featured in this book by Edgar Allan Poe. And this picture is by the same artist as a number of other books and collections. And I think it was the Pan Book of Horror, I think he illustrated, if not some Twilight Zone, no. I think it was just Pan. And, you know, if it's too dark, I will show some top-down stuff so you can see how wild that looks. And it is just quite dark and menacing and brooding with this skeletonized red-eyed face peering out from a jester's hat complete with bells. I like the typeface quite a lot. It is just sort of like a Helvetica for the horror anthology, but the Boris Karloff is sort of a rotting from the bottom zombie font. That's a really great example of old horror typography, not something that I see a lot of. It's kind of like always kind of jokey hokey, but this is kind of menacing looking. Gary Pullen, the artist that worked for Rue Morgue for a time, I use his typeface, Ghoulish, quite often. He had other typefaces that he had created that he made commercially or available. I think it's commercially available, but when you give them away for free, what is that? Is that still commercially available? But yeah. Wonderful stuff. This is right up there with that sort of font. One of my favorite fonts on the cover of an old horror anthology. Often the fonts are, like I said, kind of childish, or they're just really plain, or they use sort of like this Celtic looking font, which I don't know where that font originates from. I'm no expert. But yeah, as I'd shown off before, it was an ugly, it still is an ugly old Algonquin Regional Library, Parry Sound, Ontario, Muskoka region, if you're familiar with Ontario. On the edge of the Muskokas, from what I understand. Not close to where I had lived, but it's more south. And it's stamped with 1968 to 1999. This was an active circulation in a small library. And I came about it at a used bookstore. So, yeah. Really, really, really good find. I've taken the dust jacket off and cleaned up a little bit. It's still got like tape marks and stuff and stamps, things I can't do anything about, but I did get the stickers from the library off the spine, so I was really proud of that. And there was a sticker on the front too, which is not worth for wear. So I'm pretty happy with the state of this book, and I was very happy to be reading through it. And I often thought of myself as this, you know, woman alone at night, reading by candlelight, wanting to get creeped out, that spine tingling feeling, chasing the dragon after watching some Twilight Zone or something on the television. The artist in this left a lot of really wonderful illustrations. As I go through each of the illustrations, I'll show you what the frontispiece was for that chapter. I'm not sure if it's the same illustrator as the cover. It could be, I don't know, but I think they look really cool. This is copyright 1965, Boris Karloff, all rights reserved. And he does have a great foreword, and I'm not sure how much of a hand he had in editing this, but he did select all of the stories. So he was a horror reader. This is stuff I didn't know. Published in 1965 by Souvenir Press, that's in London, and simultaneously published here in Canada by Ryerson Press, Toronto. So this is probably why it ended up here. Not something I think that Ryerson would typically publish. But yeah, there's something very satisfying about a good horror story, says Boris Karloff. And I hope that you have bought this book because you agree with me in this thought. The one thing I did really like about this, and I didn't realize it when I first bought it, I bought it on the provenance of the name Boris Karloff alone, and that it's horror stories and old-timey ones, that the thing that he mentions in the foreword really intrigued me. A note in closing concerning this special tidbit. I'm sure that you've all read at one time or another, and most likely many years ago, The Cask of Amontillado by Edgar Allan Poe. one of the very great tales in the field of English and American letters. But, and this is the part that intrigued me. How many of us have ever read the sequel? By another hand, The Opener of the Crypt by John Jakes, which I first read when it was published some dozen years ago. Very few, I think, and therefore I include both stories in the pages that follow. And I had wondered that too. A lot of these authors are kind of contemporary. Edgar Allan Poe, not so much, but I had wondered why that was included. Was it a filler? I was in the running to be in an anthology once with a very, very prolific author. And I'm like, how did they get this reprint from this prolific author? And then why? Is it just to fill space? Is it just to get the name as a magnet? But me being a reader of that author, I would have looked at it and went, why would I want to buy that? They've obviously bought a reprint that is 30 years old to shove into this. It's a weird thing that anthologies do. But anyway, The 13th Floor by Frank Gruber. I loved this. It was so like 50s smack talking New York. Oh, it was so neat. Maybe even 30s, kind of like the attitudes. It is a slipstream story. So it takes place in maybe the 30s and the 50s. And yeah, it's a really fun little story. The sort of thing that you would want to hear on old timey radio. Or Twilight Zone. And a lot of these, if they aren't Twilight Zone episodes, I would not be surprised if they all are, they would make excellent ones. The Child of the Winds, I wasn't that into, and I didn't even finish reading the end of it because it was just really a yawn to me. Edmund Hamilton. Really good premise though, and they stick with this sort of wind and sand premise. The Cask of Amontillado by Edgar Allan Poe. If you are an EAP fan, you know how this one goes. One guy is cranky with another guy and lures him into a basement where he starts bricking him up behind a wall. And it's just like a revenge story. I thought it was fun. I have always liked the story. The visuals of it have stood the test of time. And if you've watched the House of Usher show on Netflix, then you would have really enjoyed that. The Opener of the Crypt by John Jakes is the next story, naturally. And the artwork for this chapter echoes the artwork on the cover of the book. So I was very pleased to see that. Then we have The Thing That Walked on the Wind by August Derleth. Oh, and I will say that it is a really good story by John Jakes as well. The Thing That Walked on the Wind, August Derleth, another story I did not finish. I started reading it, and that's the beauty of anthologies, is that if you're not into something, the next story, like The City Bus, will be along in 10 minutes. The Scarlet King by Evan Hunter. This was interesting too. Not my favorite story out of this. I'd have to say The 13th Floor was one of my favorites, but this next story is my second favorite. The Graveyard Reader by Theodore Sturgeon. This story is old-time radio, Twilight Zone to a T, and it very well could have been adapted. I'll have to look that up after. A man skulking about in a graveyard. What more do you need for a theme setting? I really enjoyed everything about this and the sort of twisty nature that the story takes on. The very proper attitudes of the characters involved and the somber atmosphere of graveyards and death. I think it's a little bit more of a paranormal think piece than horror. And then we come to the almost sci-fi, The Mind Worm by C.M. Cornbluth. Not one of my favorite stories in it, but it was interesting, it was twisty, it was cool, kind of body horror-ish. I thought it was fantastic that way. And a lot of sort of like Lovecraftian influence going into this. Via some of the more sci-fi stories happening at the time. Back from the Grave by Robert Silverberg was really fucking interesting. I like this story quite a lot, and I can see this sort of story having a great inspiration on someone like Stephen King. If he had read the story, I wouldn't be surprised. Man from the South by Roald Dahl. One of my first adult stories by Roald Dahl that I've ever read, and I really, really liked this. It was almost Tarantino-esque in its attitudes that people have and the very neat mix of setting and character. I really enjoyed this story. It's not horror necessarily as it is like twisty drama, but Yeah, it was very cool. It was very neat. It makes me want to read more Roald Dahl, and other people have commented and suggested other more scary stories by him, so thank you for that. The Opener of the Way by Robert Bloch, and fantastic. It was nice to have a Robert Bloch, and there is sort of like a wind and sand and desert theme in a lot of these stories that didn't grab me, but this one was interesting. Again, with sort of like that Tombs of Egypt being opened mystique that had gripped the world for the last couple decades at this point, this had an influence on horror of the time, so it was nice to have one of those entries here. And the book ends with Haunter of the Dark by Howard Phillips Lovecraft. And you can see the inspiration between the two greats of horror literature here, Poe and Lovecraft, within a lot of these stories. And then you get to see a lot of the inspirations that the authors in this anthology caused among those that may have read them. And I think that this is just a really, really, really good addition to your shelf if you collect some lesser-known older stories. If you're a big fan of Twilight Zone, radio shows, that sort of thing, from the golden age of horror, maybe. I think the golden age of horror is really the 80s, but the first golden age of horror. The gilded age of horror, the formative years of horror, perhaps, if you enjoy collecting that sort of stuff, I think this is a really good addition, and I'm really glad that I sat down on cozy rainy nights and read it, because I think that's how it was intended, right? Have you read the Boris Karloff Horror Anthology or other anthologies? I think he did other ones and edited others. The Pan Books of Horror as well ring a bell. And I think that a lot of the things that were edited by Wagner really have the same sort of collection, the usual suspects, if you will, of the authors that appear in these sorts of anthologies. I think I'm going to have to keep my eye out for more like this, because I really enjoyed feeling like a 10-year-old girl who had snuck a horror anthology of my grandmother's out of her shelf and curled up on the couch to read it at night. Let me know if you have read this. Thank you ever so much for watching, and have an ooky, spooky day.